talking blues, climb the fence, books and pens. I can tell that we are gonna be friends.
All right, so if I could ask everyone to please take your seats and double check that your cell phones are turned on vibrate. We're about ready to begin the second day of the Berlin Freedom of Expression Forum. I'm really pleased the way that the first day went. I thought in many ways we touched a lot of the big issues. Of course, we didn't answer the questions, at least not in full, but luckily we have 4 days, and so I'm hoping actually through the course of each day, we will come closer to maybe finding answers, as opposed to one answer, to some of the questions we've been discussing. This morning is also one of those lectures that I myself have very much been looking forward to. I had the chance to meet Rebecca MacKinnon for the first time this morning, and I think her lecture will really be a highlight in many ways. I'd like to say a few words of background about Ms. MacKinnon, so you can understand also the great experience that she's bringing with her to the lecture today. Rebecca MacKinnon is the Bernard L. Schwartz Senior Fellow at the New America Foundation, where she conducts research, writing, and advocacy on global internet policy, free expression, and the impact of digital technologies on human rights. She's the author of The Consent of the Network, The Worldwide Struggle for Internet Freedom. And I believe my colleague is distributing some brochures for you, too, so you can learn a little bit more about the book. There's a copy of her book downstairs, and I'd ask you not to take that, but if you want to flip through it, you're welcome to, just to get a taste for some of the work that Ms. MacKinnon has done. Ms. MacKinnon is also the co-founder of Global Voices, globalvoicesonline.org, an international citizen media network. She serves on the boards of directors for the Committee to Protect Journalists and the Global Network Initiative, a multi-stakeholder organization that advances corporate responsibility and human rights in the technology sector. She's fluent in Mandarin Chinese, and Ms. MacKinnon has also worked as a journalist for CNN in Beijing for 9 years, and was the Beijing Bureau Chief and Correspondent from 1998 until 2001. She then served as CNN's Tokyo Bureau Chief and Correspondent from 2001 until 2003. From 2004 until 2006, she was a research fellow at Harvard's Berkman Center for Internet and Society, where she began her ongoing research and writing about the Chinese internet, in addition to launching Global Voices with her colleague, Ethan Zuckerman. In 2007 to 2008, she taught online journalism at the University of Hong Kong's Journalism and Media Studies Center. In 2009, she conducted research and writings as an Open Society Fellow, and in the spring of 2010, she was a visiting fellow at Princeton's Center for Information Technology Policy. Ms. MacKinnon received her AB cum laude from Harvard University and was a Fulbright Scholar in Taiwan from 91 until 92. She's currently living in Washington, D.C. The lecture topic that she's chosen this morning, The Global Struggle for Freedom and the Control of the Internet. Please join me in a very, very warm welcome for Ms. Rebecca MacKinnon. Thank you.
By repeating a story that I tell at the very beginning of my book in the preface, because I think it's appropriate given that we're in Berlin. When I was in China working as a journalist in the 1990s, I happened to read a book by the British historian Timothy Garton Ash called The File. For those of you who aren't familiar with this book, it's about what happened here in Germany after the wall came down and people from East Germany had a chance to look at their Stasi files for the first time. And he documents the experience of many people he had actually known and whose lives he had followed from some time as they went and got their files and discovered who had been informing on them for many years and in some cases very traumatically discovering that lovers, colleagues, neighbors, sometimes close relatives had been informing on them and kind of the trauma that some people went through in making these discoveries. And so when I read this book in China, this was around 1997, I decided it'd be really interesting to discuss it with some of my Chinese friends. And so over dinner one night with some fairly sophisticated friends who work in journalism and the arts and so on, I told them about this book. And one of my friends put his chopsticks down, looked around the table and said, "Someday in China, we'll be able to do the same thing. Then I'll know who my real friends are." And the room went silent. I should say the table went silent for a few moments, and not quite sure why, you know, who was feeling a bit guilty around that table. What has struck me as I've been following and doing work around the internet, both on censorship and surveillance around the world, is that if and when China does change and people do get to see their files, it won't be so much about what human beings were spying on whom. It will be people's electronic records, their email exchanges, their cell phone text messages, the logs of where they've been on their cell phone that have been recorded through all of the electronic networks that log all of this information. And as I was writing my book, of course, the Arab Spring sort of happened in the middle of it. And there's been a lot of discussion about how the internet has facilitated challenges to dictators. People in Tunisia and in Egypt use the internet to organize against dictators and actually managed to bring down their long-standing rulers. People have been using the internet around the Middle East and North Africa and in many other places. We're seeing in Russia people using the internet to organize and express displeasure about the soon-to-be re-elected or soon-to-be reinstated President Putin. But while the internet is enabling people to challenge power, what is less clear in the Middle East and frankly elsewhere is to what extent does the internet enable people, once they have challenged power, to build a robust and sustainable democracy. And one of the interesting things that happened in Egypt, actually, a couple months after Mubarak stepped down, was that a number of activists managed to get into the state security headquarters outside of Cairo. And these are photos actually posted by activists online as they went into the state security headquarters. And here you can see a photo taken on somebody's mobile phone that they posted onto Twitter as they were going through the state security headquarters. And these are shredded documents that had been left behind. But as you can see from this other photo taken by another activist, a lot of files were left behind intact. And sure enough, when people found their own files or files on people they knew, it was a lot less about human informants. It was transcripts of people's email exchanges, their cell phone records, their instant messages, their SMS text messages on their phone, the locations from their phone, logs of activities on their computer that had been captured through their internet service providers. One activist actually found a contract that had been received by the state security services from a Western company for the sale of what's called deep packet inspection technology that assists the network administrators not only in blocking cyber attacks and securing networks, but is also very handy in tracking the users of these networks and their activity. Activists in Egypt, despite having succeeded in deposing Mubarak, of course, the transition in Egypt has been quite difficult. And activists have to assume that these technologies to track them are still being used. And so they have to be very careful, of course, about what they're doing online and with their cell phones, and assume that unless they're taking very strong technical measures to obscure their tracks and activities, that this information remains available to the transitional military government. Of course, for those of us in Berlin, will be here in Germany, will be reminded perhaps of a story that came out in the German media not too long ago, in 2010. About a Green Party politician, Malte Spitz, who requested from his cell phone operator the records of all his movements. And this I'm not sure if you can really see because the lights are so bright, so it's difficult to see the slides. There we go, that's better. But Desite actually took all the data that he had received from his cell phone operator and did a map of all his movements over the course of a period of time. And you could track very clearly what he'd been up to. And so this is one of the differences, I think, between the pre-internet age during the Cold War and today, is that everybody's being tracked everywhere, democracies and dictatorships alike. And the real difference is how this information is being used and to what extent the abuse of power is being held accountable or constrained in any way when it comes to access to our information and use of it. In Tunisia, which is also undergoing a transition, somewhat less troubled than Egypt, the head of the Tunisian Internet Agency, named Moez Chakchouk, actually came out in several speeches last fall and revealed that the Tunisian Internet Agency, under Ben Ali's long-standing regime, had been testing censorship software and technologies provided by Western companies, and then these companies would kind of refine their products accordingly and market these software packages and other technologies around the region. And Mr. Chakchouk has been quite outspoken about his desire to turn his agency from an extension of the Ben Ali regime's power and an agency that was expected to conduct censorship and surveillance on behalf of the regime, into an agency that facilitates the kinds of communication networks that are necessary for democracy and for democratic conversation. And there are a lot of arguments going on in Tunisia about how information networks should be managed. In May, actually, of last year, a number of politicians and community leaders in Tunisia called for a reinstatement of censorship. And this is a page, a screenshot taken from a browser by some activists in Tunisia in May of 2011, when at least on some networks in Tunisia, a number of Facebook pages and other websites considered to be obscene were blocked. Now, you can see that there's this block message here saying that this page has been filtered on an order of a judge at the instruction of the military tribunal. And so then a series of legal actions ensued where groups that had been very active in bringing down Ben Ali's government and using the internet to protest and organize protests challenged this. It went all the way up to the High Court in Tunisia. And just a couple weeks ago, the High Court ruled that actually this type of censorship will not be acceptable ruled against it. And so the kind of free speech advocates were victorious in this case. But it was a long struggle. And it highlighted this situation that all societies are now facing, that the citizens' relationship with government is increasingly mediated through the internet. And how do you ensure that the internet, the web platforms, the mobile services, and so on, are neutral? And that power is not being abused either by private actors or by government actors through this network. And in Tunisia, what's been very interesting is there's been a robust debate going on about what is the role of censorship and surveillance in a democracy. And when certain communities in a democracy are calling on their elected representatives to protect children or to fight crime, and they're calling for some censorship in the protection of children or in the enforcement of social mores, and that this is being, the pressure is coming through democratic constituencies on democratically elected politicians, what do you do? How do you, you're going to have surveillance of some kind there's basically no society on earth where surveillance does not happen in the name of law enforcement. But how do you ensure that's not being abused? So there's tremendous debate going on in Tunisia about this. But what's interesting is when they look to Western democracies, when they look to the older democracies of the world for answers, they see a lot of similar debates happening and a lot of unresolved questions about to what extent is censorship appropriate, to what extent should surveillance be allowed in a democratic state, how do you handle data collection, how do you prevent its abuse. A lot of very similar questions and no clear models for how do you get this balance right in order to have an internet that is compatible with free expression and democracy. So in my book, I argue, you know, there have been a lot of books written and essays and articles and debates about is the internet helping the good guys or is it helping the bad guys? Is it making us smarter? Is it making us more stupid? And I argue that that's not really the most pressing question that we need to be looking at. The most pressing and urgent question is how do we ensure that the internet evolves in a manner that is compatible with democracy, that is compatible with human rights, that is compatible for the values that people are, the values and rights and accountable governance that people around the world are risking their lives to fight for every day. And the fact that the internet, the way it is today, the way it will be in the future, is not sort of some kind of natural given. It's the result of decisions made by companies, by programmers, by engineers, by managers, by government regulators, by everybody who uses the internet, by anybody who's creating devices or software that runs on the internet. We are all contributing to how it evolves. And as the old adage goes, at least in a democracy, you get the government you deserve. We're going to get the internet we deserve, and that we need to be active in ensuring that the internet evolves in a manner that's compatible with the kind of society we want to have, and to ensure that it evolves in a citizen-centric direction that favors and empowers the citizen and holds government accountable, a government power accountable, holds corporate power accountable. And how do we do that? As I mentioned, we have a lot of debates going on in the democratic West about how to get the balance right. In the United States, there was recently a very fierce debate, and this is a screenshot taken on the day that Wikipedia went dark, turned itself off in protest over a proposed piece of legislation in the United States called the Stop Online Piracy Act, or known as SOPA, and its sister bill in the U.S. Senate, known as PIPA, the Protect IP Act. And the internet community, both companies, but also NGOs, civil rights groups, were opposed to this legislation because this legislation was seeking to address a problem that many people view is legitimate. You know, the scope of the problem and so on is up to debate, but there's a view that that intellectual property needs to have some form of protection and respect, and a great deal of concern amongst a broad array of industries that their intellectual property is being violated, and that the United States Congress needed to pass a law that would sort of address this problem. But the problem was is that the solutions being sought involved censorship, involved blocking foreign websites, and involved holding website operators liable for what their customers were doing, what their customers or users were uploading, and so on. And so what this meant was that in order to avoid legal action and perhaps even criminal prosecution, websites from Google to from for-profit Google to non-profit Wikipedia to Global Voices and so on would be expected to proactively monitor what their users were posting lest they violate copyright. And if website operators had not shown sufficient effort in preventing copyright violation by their users on their site, they could be subject to legal action. And the concern was is this would basically make it very difficult to run citizen media websites, to run any kind of site with user-generated content, because the liability would be so great and companies would have to censor proactively. And while this bill was meant to, and this is a slide with part of the online protest, somebody kind of burned a sign here with SOPA on it and spread it around the internet. The concern was is that while the legislation is meant to address a narrow problem, copyright infringement, that once the mechanisms were put in place, without sufficient due process, that they could easily be abused, that there could be mission creep and concern about what this might mean. If you start having the censorship mechanisms in place to handle copyright violation, might they also conveniently get used to deal with other problems? And if there's not sufficient due process, that could chill free expression. And throughout Europe, there's been protests. This is a photo from a protest in Poland recently to stop the ratification of a trade pact called the Anti-Counterfeiting Trade Act, which the United States and a number of its trade partners have been signing, had negotiated, and then there's been a growing movement to try and stop either signing or ratification around Europe, with the feeling that many of the features of ACTA are very similar to SOPA and PIPA in the United States in terms of increasing the responsibility of website operators to be held responsible basically for what their users were doing, and concerned that this is going to lead in a direction that is bad for free expression and that could be abused. Now, at the extreme end, of course, you have China when it comes to censorship. And most people in the West have heard of the Great Firewall of China, which is the system that blocks web pages from overseas. And this is, on a Chrome browser, what it looks like when you try to access Facebook from a Chinese network. It's blocked, and many, many thousands of websites are blocked from the Chinese networks, Twitter, YouTube, of course, parts of Global Voices, my own blog, human rights sites, of course, and lots of other websites. But that's really only the top layer of censorship in China. That actually the bulk of censorship taking place in China is being conducted by Chinese companies, not actually by the government. And that's because of a system that the Chinese government calls self-discipline. In Western legal parlance, we might call it intermediary liability, that Chinese internet companies are held responsible for everything their users are posting and transmitting on their services. And of course, because the international social media networks and most of the search engines and so on are blocked in China, people are mainly using social media websites and online services run by Chinese companies based in China. So these companies will lose their business license if they don't do an adequate job policing their users. And so this is a screenshot from a ceremony that I actually managed to attend in 2009 in Beijing. I sat way in the back, so I had to use the website page to depict the ceremony. But this was called the Self-Discipline Awards. It's an award given out every year by the Chinese Internet Society. And it's given to the top 20 web companies and organizations that do the best job of policing their users. And that year I attended this ceremony, one of the awardees was a gentleman named Robin Lee of Baidu, which is China's largest search engine. Here's an example of how the censorship works in the social media context. This is a blogging platform run by Baidu. I set up a dummy account on that platform and tried to post an article about Liu Xiaobo, the Nobel Peace Prize winner, who is doing a very long jail sentence in China right now. I couldn't even post the article. I get an error message when I try to hit publish that says, "We're sorry, your article has failed to be published. It contains inappropriate content. Please check it." And this happens very frequently on social networks in China, that you're prevented from even publishing certain things. Or if you do post something, there's also, basically all these companies have large departments full of people who are kind of monitoring and flagging things and taking down content after it's been published. So it's quite frequent that you will publish a blog post that's somewhat sensitive politically, and within a couple of hours it disappears. It's been deleted. This happens all the time on the Chinese internet. One example that kind of relates to Germany that I thought would be fun to bring up is that in China, because Twitter is blocked, there's a service called Weibo, which people use, and there's been a lot of stories in the press about how people use it to talk about problems, social problems, and so on in China. And so a lot of Western organizations, media organizations, companies, and so on, are using Weibo to reach their Chinese audiences and Chinese customers, just like Western companies use Twitter to reach Western audiences these days, and news organizations. And so Deutsche Welle had a Weibo account on which it was posting links to its Chinese language stories, because Deutsche Welle has a Chinese language service. And they had their account deleted. And then they set up a new account on which they said, you know, we've set up a new account. We never did anything against Chinese law. We don't understand why Sina, the company that runs Weibo, deleted our account. And then this pop-up comes up, final warning, your account will be deleted if you were dishonest again. And sure enough, soon thereafter, their account was deleted. And when you tried to go back to the page where their account was located, you got this error message which says, we're sorry, the page you're seeking does not exist. So this kind of thing happens very frequently in the social media universe in China. So the point being, it's not just about blocking websites and then finding a way to get around the blocks. It's that accounts and content are constantly being deleted. And then, of course, the people who are creating the content who have created the accounts, the information about them and their activities and their location is naturally shared freely by the Chinese social media companies with the authorities upon request, and sometimes proactively if they know that the government is expecting them to kind of give them a heads up on certain people. So in a way, the private sector is kind of through this essentially system of liability, or self-discipline, as it's called, acting as an extension of and a key component of China's system of censorship and surveillance. And this is what I think is not well understood about how Chinese censorship and surveillance work. So we have a situation in the world today where physical sovereign governments are either being challenged by the internet or, you know, are trying to regulate different aspects in the internet, sometimes based on a public mandate, sometimes not, depending on what the government is and what the particular political process is. But you also have increasingly these private sovereignties that and private communities with their kind of private constituencies that are developing around the world. And this is a map of social networks from December last year. And all of the blue countries are countries where Facebook is the most popular social network. And you'll see the big red country, that's of course China, where Facebook is blocked, and a Chinese network is the dominant one. And in Vietnam, where similarly it's a Vietnamese network. And then the Russian-speaking world, where you have Russian language services that are most popular, and through which the Russian government, while they do not block the internet, exercises sort of a bit of extra influence through manipulation and access to user data in a manner that is much more free, shall we say, than their relationship with Facebook. But at the same time, these networks are of course challenging the sovereignty, and you know, you saw during the Arab Spring how people used Facebook to organize against their governments and have challenged the sovereignty of many governments. So I talk about these corporate entities that whose decisions about programming, about terms of service, about what you can and cannot do on their networks as the sovereigns of cyberspace, that they are they're not like states. They can't exactly put you in jail or, you know, they can't put you in jail or tax you. And there are many things that relate to physical state power they cannot do. But at the same time, they are in many ways shaping what people know about us, how other people relate to us, how we relate to our world, what we understand about politics, how we can organize, how we can't organize, how private our information is, et cetera, et cetera. And in that way, they are exercising a kind of sovereignty over our lives, a form of governance that is private. And so I have a section in the book talking about how that works and the question of whether these companies should be expected to be considering the public interest and sort of core principles of human rights and free expression more than they currently do. One example of the contradictions is in Egypt with Facebook and, you know, with this cartoon. It kind of shows how many people in Egypt feel that Twitter played a huge role in helping to bring down the Mubarak government. But this person's face that you're seeing here is a young man named Khaled Said, who was beaten to death by the police in Alexandria in the summer of 2010. And he became kind of the poster boy for an anti-torture movement that had actually been building for quite some number of years. And he sort of gave a face to that movement. And the Facebook page that was created around him became kind of the central rallying point for a lot of the protests. One of the interesting things, however, was that the people who created this page, which included a Google executive named Vael Ghonim, who was kind of a Google executive by day and secret Facebook activist by night for quite some time, he wasn't using his real name on Facebook. Now, that is a violation of the terms of service of Facebook. People are required to use their real name, and the company reserves the right to delete your account if you're challenged and you cannot prove that you really are who you say you are. And so what happened actually was in November of 2010, a huge anti-torture demonstration was planned on a particular Friday. It happened to be in the United States the Friday after Thanksgiving. And over in Palo Alto at Facebook headquarters, somehow it was brought to the attention of Facebook staff that this account was being run by people using fake names. And so they shut down the page on the eve of this huge demonstration. And it was only because the people running this page had connections in the human rights community and in Silicon Valley that they were able to get it back up and running and negotiated an arrangement whereby an Egyptian woman living in Washington, D.C. have took over the administrative rights to the page using her real name. So this is one of the examples of how companies are kind of setting up rules of governance within their networks that has implications for human rights activists and vulnerable groups and the people who are really depending on their ability to use the site and not really considering the human rights implications and the ways in which they might be putting people at risk in the rules that they're setting and the way they govern their sites. Another example, when Steve Jobs died, people around the world were mourning his death. And this is a cartoon by an Iranian cartoonist who kind of is implying here with this kind of statement, an old man says to the angel of death, there are many dinosaurs in Iran and you go after the red apples, kind of implying that at least among some Iranians, there was more respect for Steve Jobs than for certain leaders. And this is kind of an example of how many of these products and platforms have developed global constituencies and loyalties and that people feel quite empowered by these technologies. Yet at the same time, Apple is exercising a great deal of censorship. And so, for instance, the App Store that is available to Chinese users of iPhones and iPads, politically sensitive content, such as the Dalai Lama-related apps, are all censored. But you also have situations, and there was also an incident of Stern magazine. Their app was censored because it contained some scantily clad women in the middle of it, even though that most of Stern is journalism. But the administrators of Apple decided that it was not appropriate for Apple users to receive that app because there was some slightly sensitive content in it. Or, for instance, in the United States, this political cartoonist named Mark Fiore had his app censored. And it was just satire, making fun of lots of politicians. But the administrators of the App Store decided that it was offensive to some groups and that they should not approve that app. And he only got his app approved after he received a Pulitzer Prize. But there are many other satirists who are not getting their apps approved because the Apple Store is just imposing its own criteria that are much more narrow than the free speech, kind of constitutional First Amendment free speech rights in the United States, or free speech rights as according to the International Covenant on the International Declaration of Human Rights, Article 19, and so on. And these companies, because we click the terms of service saying we agree to allow them to, you know, do what they want, there's nothing legally we can do about it. So just to kind of recap what's going on here, so increasingly our relationship as citizens is being mediated by these companies that are running our digital platforms. And sort of under this sort of traditional democratic way of thinking, citizens, you know, should be able to vote for their government representatives who then regulate the companies and hold them accountable, and then that's kind of how accountability is supposed to work, and that's how power is supposed to be constrained, because we can hold governments accountable and then they hold companies accountable. But increasingly, of course, companies are influencing government legislation directly. In the United States in particular, we have a lot of debates about that. And you also have companies influencing what citizens know and can do and so on online and are the way we function. And so in my book, I argue that citizens need to direct more activism and demands and collective bargaining basically directly at companies if we want our rights to be protected, because you can't really, you know, in some cases you might be able to count on government to regulate companies properly, but in many other cases, actually, the regulations are not necessarily compatible with civil liberties in the first place. So there's going to need more activism to be directed at companies. And you also have the problem where one government, in regulating internet companies, is affecting people all over the world who didn't vote for that government, and those people have no way of holding that government accountable. And companies in, you know, Palo Alto or wherever they're based that have global users are, of course, being driven by a worldview and a set of experiences of engineers and managers that are located in a particular culture and impacting people around the world of very different cultures and political contexts and not really necessarily being able to anticipate what those consequences are and, depending on the company, caring or not about those consequences. So which is why I argue, in particular, there needs to be more global activism directed at companies for that reason. Now, after showing a very complicated graphic, I'm going to near my conclusion with a funny video, because I think this helps to highlight the point I make in the book about how sovereignty and power is somewhat incongruous in the internet age.
There's majority in the case of
be
all
quiet. I order you to be quiet.
Order? Who does he think he is?
I'm your king.
Well, I didn't vote for you.
You don't vote for kings.
Well, how'd you become king then?
The Lady of the Lake, her arm clad in the purest shimmering samite, held aloft Excalibur from the bosom of the water, signifying by divine providence that I, Arthur, was to carry Excalibur. That is why I'm your king.
Listen, strange women lying in ponds distributing swords is no basis for a system of government. Supreme executive power derives from a mandate from the masses, not from some farcical aquatic ceremony.
Be quiet!
Oh, but you can't expect to wield supreme executive power just because some watery tart threw a sword at you.
Shut up!
So what I love about this video, I love many things about this video, but as far as my talk today is concerned, what's great about this video is it juxtaposes two completely different ways of thinking about power and governance and legitimacy. And there was a time when basically everyone on the planet assumed that the only way to organize power and the only kind of legitimate power was that bestowed by some kind of divinity onto some kind of sovereign who then governed us, and that was just kind of our lot, and we just had to hope that we had a benevolent sovereign as opposed to an evil one. But we evolved, and human society has innovated politically, we evolved to this notion of consent of the governed, and that power only has legitimacy when it is derived from the consent of those who are agreeing to basically bequeath this power to a governing entity because that's in the collective interest. And so the question is, how do we kind of sustain that in the digital age when sort of the notion of consent of the governed and constraining the abuse of power by governments or by private corporations is very much grounded within the nation state. But now, for all the reasons I just described, you have power being exercised across borders, you have power being exercised globally by private entities, and we're not doing a very good job of figuring out how to constrain the abuse of power to hold it accountable through digital networks. The current kind of structures of politics and geopolitics are not working so well for us very well. And so we need to figure out how to get from consent of the governed to consent of the networked. And what I argue in my book is that we're at something of what I call a Magna Carta moment. Not that we need more people to write more documents resembling the Magna Carta. I think actually there's been a number of people who've been writing kind of bills of rights for the internet that derive from international human rights law that are actually quite good. The point is that we're at a moment in time where we're coming to recognize that the old ways of organizing power and constraining power and defining legitimacy are not working so well for us anymore. But we're a long way from figuring out what the alternative should look like and how to implement it. I think one of the other important elements of the internet age is what I call the digital commons, loosely defined. It's that in addition to governments and companies, you know, citizens are not completely unorganized and not making a contribution, that actually a lot of the standards and software that makes the internet what it is today were developed by engineers, by software programmers for reasons that were not, for motivations that were not commercial and not political, but had to do with research, had to do with community building, had to do with many other things. And so there's a whole universe of what one might call digital civil society that has arisen. And I argue in the book that without a robust and healthy digital commons, we will not be in a good position to push back sort of on abuse of power when it happens by governments and corporations, and that having a robust digital commons is critical to where we're going to go. Just to end with a final thought, I want to quote a professor of journalism at the University of Austin, Texas, named Rosenthal Alves. He likes to talk about the pre-internet age as a desert, as an information desert. It was a polity, an economy, an entire universe of government, governance and economics that was based around information scarcity. But then the rains came, and now we're in a rainforest. And it's a whole new set of rapidly proliferating organisms, many of which are completely new. The kind of governance, the kind of economy that you build in a rainforest is very different than what works in a desert. And we're in the very early stages of figuring out how to build a civilization in the rainforest that's sustainable, that protects the weak against abuse by the strong, that is in which governance is possible, but is fair and just, and power is held accountable. We haven't yet worked out how to construct that kind of civilization in cyberspace. We're in the very early days, but I think the good news is that we're recognizing that we need to move there and that we all need to work together. And just the final conclusion is that I think we're in a very exciting time, because the future is really up to us. It depends for those of you who might be students, for those of you who might be working in NGOs, those of you who might be in companies or academia or the media. This is a time when all of us can make a difference. And if we're in media, raising public awareness about what's going on, and giving citizens the tools and information to to hold the exercise of power in cyberspace accountable. As researchers, there's a tremendous amount of research that needs to be done about exactly how power is being exercised throughout digital networks, and who is responsible for what and how these dynamics work. For civil society, just as we had an environmental movement over the past several decades that really moved the needle in terms of how companies behave and the extent to which they behave in a sustainable manner, really moved the needle in terms of government policy and regulation on environment. I think similarly we can really move things in a direction we want to see when it comes to internet rights and a democracy-compatible internet. But it's not going to happen inevitably and inexorably. It's going to require that people take responsibility for how the internet is evolving and play their part. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Ms. MacKinnon. That was really more than I expected in terms of content and inspiration. So I think it was really an excellent lecture for many reasons. Only challenge we have, we were supposed to start the next lecture about 10 minutes ago.
So we
want to do questions and discussion, but I think we will have to be efficient. So what I'd suggest is we have this 30-second rule at ICD. So if we could limit it to 30 seconds, one question each, and then if you could briefly stand and also introduce yourself when posing the question, that'll be helpful for the documentation purposes as well. I see a few hands. Maybe we'll do ladies first, and then we'll come here. Could we maybe collect three or four questions or comments together, and then you could offer a response?
Sure.
Excellent.
Hello, my name is Anila Sinanovic. I come from Slovenia. I'm writing my thesis about intellectual property in the digital world and piracy. I was currently also in the protest against ACTA here in Berlin last Sunday. What I want to say is today, ACTA is a hot debate in EU. The problem seems to be the free files on the internet, and on the other hand, industry and authors. The ACTA is trying to limit using of internet, on the other hand, is breaking the state rights. When someone is illegally downloading file, there is not clear what is legal and what is illegal, and how those illegal downloaders are going to get punished. People say that with ACTA is basic human rights, and internet is fundamental rights. And Creative Commons wants to get information who are stealing intellectual property. And on the other hand, neither the police have this priority. My question is, do you think that we can find creative solution? And do you think that with writing reports and resolutions, do we apply this in the practice too?
Jerry Edling, I can remember at the outset of the debate over, for example, Google operating in China and things like that, when some of those companies were practically pleading with the United States government to get involved and set down some ground rules so that they would be free to challenge China. And of course, it didn't happen, and to a certain extent, they've backed, well, actually Google pulled out of China. But my question is there a proper role of government in getting involved in that, or should it evolve more organically?
That's a good question.
Is freedom of the internet an absolute? Partly because I'm thinking of and also a related question is about, very interesting about all these campaigns are gone, net neutrality, SOPA, PIPA, ACTA. There's a company which is, whose first name begins with G, which seems to be the most active involved. Now, is this really actually no little more than a kind of commercial interest of that particular company and related companies?
Yeah. since we're out of time, I'll try and kind of touch on some issues. Just to answer your question, I think we do have to come at creative solutions. And I think part of the problem with all of these copyright laws speak to a larger problem of democratic countries trying to solve legitimate problems, at the behest of constituencies who are demanding solutions. But I think one of the problems that we've seen is that in seeking solutions, have all the affected stakeholders been consulted? Or are the solutions really kind of being mainly coming out of the recommendations of the quote-unquote injured parties, the aggrieved parties? And then the aggrieved parties say, here's what the solution should be, and then the legislatures and the trade negotiators then kind of go and try to impose the solution, and now there's a backlash. And so how do we ensure that as we try and establish laws and kind of a new set of rules, that there's sufficient buy-in, that there's sufficient legitimacy of these rules, that people will actually be interested in respecting those rules? if you're going to have law enforcement be effective, if everybody hates the police and thinks the police is not acting in their interest, they will defy the police and crime will not go down. You have to have the community believing that the police are actually on their side. Similarly, when it comes to any kind of quote-unquote enforcement of any kind of rules, the rules themselves and the enforcement mechanisms needs to be sufficiently, have sufficient legitimacy with a broad set of stakeholders. And I think this is one of the problems we've had with intellectual property. And it's a problem we have with a lot of solutions that people are seeking to a lot of problems in democratic societies that emerge on the internet. This question about the role of government, I think there certainly is a role of government. I think it's important that particularly democracies, I think there's a process that's starting to go on in the OECD of formulating kind of core principles for human rights in the internet, and that's important, and that democratic governments sort of agree that yes, we support human rights in the physical world, and similarly human rights and protections of rights, free expression, privacy, right to assembly, and so on, need to extend equally in the digital world, and that politically there's a commitment to do so. With regulation, there's been some companies, including Google, have called on U.S. government, other governments, to kind of take action under WTO to designate censorship as a barrier to trade. That's been very difficult to sort of get that together just because of the nature of the way the trade system works and the exceptions for kind of cultural, issues and, the right of governments to kind of define, what is acceptable speech and so on, and they keep getting tripped up. And also because other trade agreements kind of contradict free speech also, so it's kind of very contradictory. But I think there is a role of government, and we should be expecting our governments to take leadership in the right way as opposed to the wrong way. And there's a mix of both coming from democratic governments at the moment. In terms of freedom being an absolute right, I mean, in the physical world, I often am party to kind of discussions with Chinese government officials that kind of often end up like this. What are you saying? We should have a free internet? We can't just allow crime and this and that, and people do whatever they want on the internet. Then it's going to be chaos, and then everybody's identity is going to be stolen, and everybody's going to get hacked. And of course, there has to be governance, and that's true. And so, just as in the physical world, when we talk about freedom, we're not talking about a Hobbesian state of nature, right? We're talking about freedom in the context of rights. And freedom of the context, in the context of just governance and accountable governance. And I think that in the physical world, that's what we mean by freedom. And I argue in the book that that's really, I think, what we should mean in the digital world as well, because all the nasty things that people do in the physical world have also extended into cyberspace. There's a lot of victimization and crime and whatnot that's serious and real. And people are calling on governments to do something about it, and companies to do something about it. And so governance on the internet is inevitable. So I think that the argument that the internet should be a place where no government should be allowed, I think, is a utopian and unrealistic notion. But if there's going to be governance, it needs to be based on consent. I don't want it to be based on, I want it to be Lockean, I don't want it to be Hobbesian. You know, I want it to be democratic governance, right? I want the abuse of power to be constrained. I want power to be held accountable. I want human rights to be protected. I want dissent to be possible. That's the kind of governance we need on the internet. If it's going to be compatible with democracy, if it's going to be compatible with free expression and human rights. And we haven't worked out how to construct that kind of governance across these global platforms where you have so many different kinds of governments and so many different kinds of companies and everybody with lots of different agendas. And so that's what I argue we need to work towards. So we're probably out of
time. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in expressing our sincere gratitude to this Kathleen MacKinnon. Thank you.